Well, there's a lot of information there, and I know you told me the one blathering was gonna be long, but I haven't listened to all the way through the second one yet because it came out this morning, and I was very busy today, and it's hard to listen. It's hard to actively listen to a conversation that you've already had without feeling like you're.
Oh, I know.
Egotistical maniac.
Like, I can't do it. By the time I've edited it, I never want to hear it again.
Yeah, exactly, right?
10 years from now, I might go back and listen and go, oh, yeah, that was all right, or whatever. But I saw it come up in my feed this morning. I started listening to it, and I thought, no, I've heard this 40 million times. I don't want to listen to this again.
Oh, that's shit. Okay. Yeah, I start to wonder what my family thinks. They walk in on me listening to us. It's going like, what?
Well,
how do you have time for that?
You're entitled to listen because you haven't heard the edit, so you need to know how it went. Let's play some music. Let's do that thing. I can't remember where we finished up last time.
Well, you and I both made new lists here because I got inspired because you put up a new list. So I'm like, well, I'll throw up a new list too. But we're still not even halfway through previous list, right?
Yeah, no. I was just add that to the list so that you know. We've got more to choose from, but I've got notes on the previous list, so I'll stick for my stuff. I'll stick with that because I've got notes made.
Oh shoot! I should make notes.
But I was going through the Bill Laswell stuff. That was a journey. He's got so much stuff up on Bandcamp. I don't know if you've looked at it.
I have.
It's incredible.
That's when I saw Praxis. So I was kind of like, when you picked Praxis, I was like, okay. Because I meant to, but I kept forgetting to go to, because I was so focused on Ipecac and my labels that I'd picked, you know.
Of course.
I kept forgetting about MOD.
There's a bit of Klaus Schulze there as well.
Yes.
Oh, man. The thing about the Bill Laswell stuff was it was really weird how it happened because you and I were talking about doing the show and we figured it out. We'd need to get permissions. So I was going getting permissions from everybody and I hadn't had any replies yet. And I was going, oh, I don't know if this is going to work out or not. I better go and see if I can find some other music on Bandcamp. So I just clicked on one of the, I don't know if you know, you probably know on Bandcamp, but there's a sort of feed that slides past, which is all the new releases or the releases that are being promoted, and I just saw this interesting looking album cover and I clicked on it and bugger me if it wasn't Bill Laswell. My head just went boom, Bill Laswell's on Bandcamp. And it's not just that Bill Laswell's on Bandcamp, there is tons of Bill Laswell stuff on Bandcamp, all under MOD or MOD, whatever he calls it. So I thought, well, that's just the universe saying, well, here you go. So I thought, I have to write to them. So I wrote to them. I got a reply almost straight away. I said, yeah, just use what you want. Really? Okay. And then I found Dark Side of the Moog stuff on there, which you can't get on CD. It's gone, you know. And it's, you know, if you want to pay £100 for one. But it's good. It's there, you know, you can listen to it. And the Axiom Ambient stuff, the Praxis stuff, Seven Souls. I found the remixes of Seven Souls, which is great. So much good stuff. So much good stuff.
Right on. So you're thinking, you said you're feeling something from your first list, or where did we leave off? Who was the last song we played? Was it your pick or my pick? Usually I'm on top of that.
I don't know. What was the last? This is terrible. What was the last song we played? I don't remember. I should know.
I think the second last show, we started off with Tower of Lies, I think, right off Wizard.
We did, yes. I want to say that.
So I think if we go on that logic, that was my pick, right? Or did you? No, we. I can't.
No, it was my pick.
What's your song?
We talked about it. Yeah, it's my song.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, yeah, okay.
So hold on, I'm just going to confirm. I'm looking at the last show, which was show six.
Oh, you'll see the album artwork.
Yeah.
Which I think is great. You do that too, by the way.
Spotlights. I think it was Spotlights was the last thing.
All right. Then.
Yeah, it was Spotlights.
So that would be
So that was one of yours. Yes, I get to choose. But what will I choose? I don't know. We're not gonna go with Bill Laswell because that's a whole. We could probably do a whole show just with Bill Laswell stuff because I think we both like him. You like Bill Laswell? You big sort of fan or?
I haven't dug so deep, you know. But I'm like I like. The stuff he got involved with like Parliament Funkadelic and those guys and everything, and then I also like
yeah.
and Praxis. Like, I absolutely love, like, that mutatis, whatever it's called. I have that CD. Like, I don't know, like, that's a hard CD to come by. And I had that on CD, you know. And
I used to have it, and it went during the purge. I sold about 500 CDs at one point. Oh, God. Why? Why did I do it? Because I needed the money. That's why.
Well,
I tell you what, since it's my choice, why don't we start with that? I mean, it's not on my list. I don't have any notes about it, but we're talking about it, so why don't we do that? We'll play that track from the Transmutation album.
So I haven't listened to this album in a while to be able to, like, even speak to that song, because the only song in the album that in my head that I know for sure sounds like is Animal Behavior, which, you know, would be if there was a single on the album, that probably would have been it.
I think it actually was released as a single. I was doing some reading on that album, and it was released. That was the single off the album. It was released on CD with a couple of other tracks from the album, so you can get that as a separate CD. That was in the days when, you know, singles used to come out on CD as well. The great days of old. The thing about Bill Laswell for me is that I don't like everything he does. I don't like everything he's involved in. But I like enough of it to always be curious. And he was a guy that I never sought out. He wasn't like, you know, I don't know how we come across music. It's a different thing for everybody. Some people tell you about it. Some people, you know, you just come across them in newspapers or reviews or on YouTube these days or wherever. But Bill Laswell was just one of these guys that kept turning up on albums that I liked, like as the bass player. You know, like the Public Image album, just called Album. He was on that. He did some work with the guys from Cannes. He was on that. He did work with Ja Wobble. So I was into all those guys. And this guy, Bill Laswell, kept turning up. And then I would see in the record shop, I would see a Bill Laswell album. And I started getting into him that way. But he's really done hundreds and hundreds. He's on literally hundreds, or possibly by this point, even thousands of albums, because he's one of these guys, I don't think he ever says no. If he met us and we said, Bill, would you be on our... He'd probably say yes. As far as I can tell, he's just one of these guys that just does everything that comes to him. Although I'm rather worried, because I don't think he's done much in the last five or six years. His last sort of outing, I think, was in 2017. So I don't know whether he's ill or whether it's just we're not getting the stuff. I couldn't find out anything about him. So I hope he's all right. I hope he's still on the go and still making music. But this is an older album. I can't remember. This is from about 1990, I think. I think that would be about right.
Definitely the 90s, yeah.
And it's by his super group. Is that, this was the one that was his super group, Praxis, wasn't it?
Yeah, like, yeah, definitely. Like, it's Bernie Worrell on keys, Brain on drums, Buckethead on guitar, Bootsy Collins on bass.
Buckethead on guitar.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, it's a curious album, because it is, at first you think, oh, this is going to be a death metal album. And then it turns into a progressive album, and then it turns into a jazz album. It's got all these different things on it, which you and I know we've talked about this a lot, that you and I love. But taken as a whole, the album is like, it's like encrusted with all these jewels that you discover as you re-listen to it. And not all of it's comfortable. That's the thing. That's the thing about Laswell. Not everything he does is comfortable. It's not. He's not always going to give you something that you go, oh, that was great. So sometimes you have to endure what he's giving you, because he's doing it. He's doing it for a reason. You know, some of the death metal stuff that he does, which is, you know, painful, and then it'll just boom, and it'll open out into a really nicely produced kind of ambient space, and you realise the reason he gave you that death metal nonsense at the start was to just get your ears washed out, ready for the glorious expansion.
Exactly.
So, yeah. And the most recent stuff that he's done, I think Against Empire we have here on the list as well, is really well produced. And he actually made some notes about it being a different production technique, and you can really tell. But we'll get to that. Yeah, I think we should start with this Praxis track. So this is Crash Victim Black Science Navigator by Praxis from the album Transmutation Mutatis Mutandis.
And just a fun fact, if you exchange Bootsy Collins for Les Claypool. You have Colonel Claypool's bucket of Bernie brains.
Okay.
Those two tracks together, I'd say to be Crash Victim, to me, sounds like it's right up, it's a Buckethead composition. I'm pretty sure that's a Buckethead song, or he come up with that, and, you know, everybody kind of jammed in on there, because it has the Buckethead rhythm and the noodly kind of stuff he loves to do. And then that second bit at the end there, the Black Science Navigator part, where that, you know, was... causing laughter, and it's that to me sounded like something that was heavily Bill Laswell to me. What was going on there? That's, you know, that wouldn't happen without him in the room, and I just love it. I love that stuff. I love that juxtaposition. I love the exploration, the experimental stuff. You know, Praxis for me has always been like... Buckethead's a hard musician to take seriously, but I find it's easy to take him seriously when he collaborates. So I was listening to some parts of Chinese Democracy today, that Guns N' Roses album, right, which has Buckethead. He plays guitar on that album, right? And, you know, and it's unmistakable when you hear him play guitar. It's undeniably him. And I've loved going through the whole rabbit hole of Buckethead and listening to all this stuff. And then when I found Praxis, it was like this beacon in the fog, you know, and this was the album, you know, so it was very, you know, there's so much about this, you know, it helped inform where it went next. Cause I was young, like I was young when I got this album. So I remember my musical tastes still weren't fully formed yet, you know, and this was out there. Like this is the kind of stuff when, you know, my friends would go like, what do you listen to? And I'd be like, you have no idea. You've never heard of it before. You know, you won't even like it, you know, and they'd be like, you're right on all accounts. Never heard of it. I don't want to hear it again. And I'd be like, perfect. You know, so, and it's glad too, because these are the CDs and stuff we're talking about, like the ones I bought that I'm glad I have, you know, because I like when I go to see people selling them used and they're selling them for way more than I paid for it, you know, and, you know, like I got Mike Patton records that are like that too, you know, and it's, and I just love that. I love when you have like that gem that sort of like exists, you know, and this is one of those things for me. And it sounds great. Like it's, even though it's like a, you know, I don't know how much money goes into production like this, but I think it sounded great.
Mm. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that was around, it doesn't say here on the Bandcamp page because it didn't arrive here until 2016, but I think it's from around 1990, around that time. It was the first Praxis album, that one, so.
It was, yeah.
Yeah, and that was one that I had as well. Yeah, I definitely had that one, and it was, well, as you say, one of those curiosities that you kind of, you poke with a stick from time to time, and every time you play it, it blows your mind in a different way.
It does, and they've, and it doesn't reflect, like, on any other, like, that album, Sacrificed, with, like, John Zorn on it, right? Like, that album is a ridiculous record, you know? And, what's the other one? Metatron or something like that? Metatron is another one. And Buckethead's on there again, but it's completely different. And it's like a scaled down version. Like, I don't think there's any keyboards on it, you know? And I don't know. These guys are just... And Surge. Surge was, I think, on their last album. I think it was their last album, or maybe second last album. They did a song on there called Sulfur and Cheese. I don't remember that
right.
one. And Surge works with Buckethead, too. Like, I love the stuff he does with Buckethead. He's... I don't know how much Surge you listen to or not.
It hasn't reached my radar, no.
System of a Down? You know those guys?
I know those guys, yeah.
Yeah, their singer, that guy. Surge Tankian.
He's very angular, isn't he?
Yeah, and he's like, he has like this Middle Eastern kind of vibe to him a bit.
Yeah.
You know, and
yeah, their music's mad. I've heard a bit of them.
I saw them live one time.
All right.
Mars Volta opened for them too, which was just,
oh wow,
like historic, you know. And I don't know who in the right mind would voluntarily follow Mars Volta, because it wasn't a good idea. It didn't help. It didn't help System of a Down at all.
On the notes here, you've put art as catharsis. Is that the label, or is that a commentary on the music?
That's the label. That's one of the labels that gave us permission.
Right. Okay. Good.
Yeah.
So good for them. Good for
it is,
art as catharsis.
Yeah, and I even, like, when I contacted the guy, I even commented on how much I love the name of the label, because, you know, my music is almost always an act of catharsis. So I just thought, you know, I love that. I love thinking about music as an emotion, and the music being an emotional reaction to how you're reflecting on your instrument, you know, and how it's, you know, because we talk about deeply listening, right? So when I'm playing my acoustic guitar, I'm also in an act of deep listening, even though it's me playing it. You know, and then it's my own emotional desires that inform my next moves, right? So it's like I'm playing the music I need to hear in the moment, and I think unless you're willing to do that, I don't know if the music comes off as convincing, you know, because if you're not putting your body and soul and movement into it, I don't think people are going to be able to resonate with it in the same way, you know. So
It's interesting. Earlier in the week, we were talking about the idea of deep listening, and we haven't really talked about that in any depth, but we had a sort of a back and forth on it, and we exchanged some links and things like that. I ended up buying a book by Pauline Oliveros, who's I think is considered as the founder of the deep listening movement, which is a therapeutic and academic movement devoted to the idea of deep listening. But it comes into the realm of art as catharsis as well. It's using deep listening as an act of self-contemplation. And the book has a few of her pieces are actually written in prose. So she gives you instructions on what to do. So you could hold a deep listening retreat, and you could perform Pauline Oliveros' pieces just by following the instructions. And it's things like close your eyes and concentrate on your breathing, try and find your heartbeat and tap out the rhythm of your heartbeat. And as you do that, think about a note and the note will come to you. And don't try and modulate the note, just have the like this sort of thing. So you've got 20 people on a circle all doing that, you know, and out of that something arises. So that was, I thought that was very interesting. And then of course, having found that, the whole sort of thing, the whole thing opened up through YouTube and various internet searches. It turns out there are academic institutions devoted to deep listening, and you know, people have been writing about it for a long time. So that was quite an eye-opener this week for me. I think it was last week and this week.
Neat. That's awesome. I like that idea of that too, like that, just this, you describing that, like the pounding the chest and the humming, like I'm already thinking that that's how my next song is going to start.
So yeah, it's very it's inspirational to see that somebody else has thought about this with that depth. And of course, you can really only do that in the comfort zone of academia, if you're left alone to do it. Because if you were trying to put that idea out through Bandcamp, as we are trying to do, you would get to the same place that we've got to, which is probably nowhere at all. You know, we got a few listeners, but we don't have, you know, when you look up Pauline Oliveros, you find all these people, you know who she is and know what she stood for and what she was trying to do. And that comes through the academic and therapeutic kind of side of it, you know, which means that people have probably written theses and doctorates and stuff like that about the whole idea. And it's very interesting. One of the problems with it, though, is when you actually listen to some of the things that she did, they're not, I would say they're not that. They don't sound like that when you come to them just as a listener, as someone who wants to deep listen. They're often quite off-putting, I think. There's a beautiful album, I think it's called Deep Listening. I think I sent you the link to that one, is just... I think it's in that cistern under the ground, and it's all this big reverb and all of that, and that's an absolutely beautiful album. And you can see with those kind of sounds, you could go into a meditative state, and you could, your rhythms of your body would stabilize, and you can see all kinds of things in that. But somebody playing a squeaky accordion. Cathartic, it's not cathartic to me, it's the opposite, you know. So there's still a matter of taste there.
Yeah.
It still has to be something that you find interesting. There's no sort of absolute, you know, here's my version of a cathartic song, therefore you must like it because it's cathartic to all humans. No, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that at all.
Well, have you, like, using that squeaky accordion sound as a thing, because I know that's a very polarizing instrument, but have you found something that you for a long time found polarizing, and then one day all of a sudden it clicked and it sounded good to you? Because that's happened to me a handful of times, you know, where, you know, like there's like a certain genre of music I couldn't stand because of a certain motif that there was constantly used, and all of a sudden it sounded good, and then the door opens up to me, you know.
I'm struggling to think of an example of that. I think we were talking earlier about Led Zeppelin. I think probably they were one of those I just dismissed. But I tend to make the mistake of dismissing things rather than having a listening experience and going, oh, I don't like that. I just dismiss it without understanding it. I've done that a few times. I think,
yeah,
we talked about that before. I've done that a few times and then come back to it and thought, oh God, why did I ever think that was terrible? I do that with a lot of things in my life, and I try not to, but I'm the kind of person who gets so invested in everything that I'm experiencing that I don't want to have bad experiences. So if something looks like it might be a bad experience, I just close the doors on it. I'm playing a computer game just now that I did that with, you know, and it's broken through, and it's brilliant, and it's made me realize how brilliant it is, and I was wrong. So yeah, it does happen, but not necessarily with music. Maybe there are a couple of genres that I dismiss and I have tried to like them, and that's romantic and classical era music and country music, the country and western music. Yeah. And we were exchanging messages earlier about Nashville. You'd yeah. found this. Was it a deep listening thing based around Nashville? Was that what that was?
It wasn't really based around Nashville. Like, now, unfortunately, I wasn't deeply listening to the documentary because it was on while I was at work. So I was doing a report while it was playing in the background, but my ear was always on it. And I kept hearing voices of people I recognized, you know, like, there's that mixing engineer, Andrew Shelps, whatever his name is, or Sheps. And Reggie Watts was in there, the beatboxing guy.
He's great.
Yeah, you know, so there was some people to talk, and just talking about like their intimate experience with like understanding the world through their music and through their expressions. It got a little twisted. By the end of it, it was more about, you know, high fidelity music being wasted on the masses, which I thought was kind of a weird turn.
I saw that at the beginning as well, and I was kind of uncomfortable about that. But that's a good example of where I've just cut the thing off. I saw Nashville, and I went, right, I'm out. So maybe if I'd known Reggie Watts was there, I would have persevered. I'll go back and have another look at it and see what they're on about. Interesting.
And the thing, and it was funny, the reason, like, because I understand, like, I'm not a huge fan of country music either, but Nashville is more than that. Country music is a big part of Nashville, but like Nashville is also like the home of a lot of classic rock albums, and you know, like when it came to like one of the best recording studios in the game was in Nashville, and there was a lot of hit records coming out of there. And guys like Jack White, you know, he's from Nashville, you know, and Jack White, someone who for years I dismissed him. And then his I think I heard a song by him called Lazaretto. And I was like, oh my God, this is not only good, this is cutting edge. This guy is like redefining what music can be. And which is actually right around the time we started actually doing that, because I found he was always kind of like towing backwards. Like he was always trying to like hearken to something from before, where then when he just stopped doing that and started pushing forward, is when I really started to love him. And then I could appreciate everything else he did before that. It's like it all kind of was like this big aha moment for me, you know? So that for me, like Nashville is more like a history thing. Like the same reason, like same way, you know, like New Orleans is for jazz, you know, Nashville was for like radio music almost for all of like North America at one point. You know, it's like a birth of something more than just that. But and country is something too that I've struggled. And there's a couple country musicians, modern country musicians that I'm a fan of now. Like there's a guy called Hank III, who's Hank Williams II's son, or Hank Williams' grandson. You know, and his stuff. I think you'd really enjoy Hank III. You'd be like, well, if this is country music, I dig this. You know, it's called dark country or something, or like it's very different. Sturgill Simpson, though, is the guy I was trying to think of before. Sturgill Simpson is, I think, a fantastic artist. Like he has an album he released about 4 or 5 years ago called A Sailor's Guide to the Galaxy. And it was a song or an album he wrote for his son. His firstborn son was coming into the world. He wrote this album, and it's like jazz fusion country. You know, but not like not like exciting in your face. Like it sounds like something George Benson would have done, or like Wes Montgomery, but like country, you know. And there's a country cover of a Nirvana song in there that just like it makes the song sound. It makes Kurt Cobain sound like a brilliant songwriter because it's approached in such a more tasteful way, you know. But I get it. I do understand the dislike for country. And I understand why certain classical music would like turn you off, because there's so much about it that's just, it feels overdone, that feels like contrived. It's just like, I don't know, there's country music, I think was, not country music, classical music, I think in a lot of cases was being used to portray like more defined imagery that I think if you approach it from like an exciting or like a deep listening kind of aspect or like a standpoint, like the way you would listen to No Quarter by Led Zeppelin, you're going to find yourself disappointed because you're going to hear a lot of the same things over and over again, and the same ideas being reused and the same harmonies, because they're all telling the same stories and painting the same pictures, right? Where I think I agree with you that until guys like Stravinsky come around, when you start going like, okay, this is good, I can wrap my head around this, I can get on board with this, because this is exciting, this is, you know, it's rhythmically unique, it's harmonically unique, you know, it's upsetting at certain points where you're going like, why, you know, like, why does this exist, you know, and you realize there's a whole room of people dedicated to making this happen, and you're like, this is awesome, you know, so it's, you know, there's a lot to that. So I get all that. I do. But yeah, you might enjoy that documentary. But the thing about it, like I said to you too, was there was nothing in there that surprised me. Nothing. I didn't learn anything. I just felt like this. I was watching a handful of people trying to describe ineffable things about their relationship to their art that resonated with me deeply. And I thought that was nice, you know, and I actually recommended it or sent it to you before I even watched it. It has popped up and I was like, hey, check this out, yeah. Peri. And then I hit play and I started watching it myself or listening to it more than watching it. But
we'd obviously been doing the same sort of searches because it came up for me as well. You know, before you sent it to me, I'd already dismissed it.
There you go.
So I'll go back and have another look at it.
I was going to say, that's weird, because that video's only got like 1,000 views or something, or 2,000 views. Like, it's not even a viral video, and it's 2 years old.
Yeah, but if you're searching for deep listening. Something like that,
yeah,
you're gonna get the few things that come up to do with deep listening on YouTube. The thing about country music is I find it very predictable, and they're litigious as well. A lot of the participants are very possessive about their music, you know, which I don't like. I might be wrong, but the story I heard was that, this is what I think is happening, I might be wrong. In country music, there's only so many chord changes and melodies that get used. So in order to allow new artists or existing artists to write new songs, there's a gentleman's agreement which has been put in place by various court cases, but it's now a gentleman's agreement, that they won't sue one another over melodies or chords. But what they will sue one another over is the lyrics. So the story I heard was that there's two guys in an elevator going to a meeting, and one of them is a musician who's just written a song, and he's telling his friend, or this guy in the elevator at least, he said, oh, I just wrote this new song. It's about, and the other guy stops him and says, don't tell me. Don't tell anybody what the song's about. He says, all I need is the first two lines of your song, and by the time you get to the meeting, I'll have copyrighted that. Because that's the only thing that can be copyrighted now. So he was telling his friend or whoever it was, you know, don't keep it close to your chest, because you don't want other people taking a slice of that. So that whole sort of country thing is, it's a machine, you know. It really is a machine that sort of churns out this. But then so is all of pop music. Any music that's pop, which country and Western is huge all over the world.
Yeah.
Huge. You know, it's huge here. I mean, the country artists can come here and fill an arena, you know. And it's the same song time and time again. You know, like pop music is that now as well. There's that. What is that chord sequence that they're all using? Somebody made fun of it, and I can't remember what the chord sequence is. But they said, "Oh, it was." I can't remember his name. But he said every song in the charts is just that chord sequence, and he went through them all, and he sang them all the different songs to this one chord sequence. And I went, "Yeah, that's where we're at." Yeah. So I kind of shy away from that stuff. It's the antithesis of what I'm interested in.
Yeah,
you know, it's death to music.
I do agree with that, and you know, it could be true for all the country, because I haven't found much I liked, because I have always told myself that every genre has that problem. You just have to like go through it to find the real stuff, you know, like, because you know, there's the same could be said about heavy metal, you know, at certain ages too, you know, like where like all the popular metal had to have like a certain tempo and a certain kind of like chugginess or whatever it is, you know, and the same with the pop music of any sort, like the stuff that seems to like get the public's attention always has this like common thread that has to sort of exist, you know, and then if you dig deeper, you get like the real deal, you know, and. But I haven't found that much with country. It's very sparse for me, and I don't know if it's because I just don't like country music, or it doesn't exist. I don't know. But Anyway,
I got some country
I got some country music for us right here, but it's not, I mean, it's not really country music. It's just music from a country.
Well, that
this music's this music's recorded in a country about another country in a different place.
Right.
So we're gonna go with, it's gonna be an Arthur Catharsis band. It's from the upper list. It's the Hashshashin. It's the song, or the album is called Badakhshan, which is actually like a city or a town or a village or something that's on the border of Afghanistan. And it's in the region of, I guess, like Tajikistan or something. I'm not sure the how to pronounce all those Ishtan names from the Middle East. And even though I'm good with geography, the Middle East is kind of like a blurry black hole for me. I've never like stared at that part of the map and memorized that mess, you know. And so it's just whatever. So these are some guys in Australia writing music about some place that's supposed to be a unique spiritual, like a hub, a cultural hub in the Middle East there that's kind of unknown to the rest of us. And yeah, so this album is supposed to be a tribute to that, I guess. And this song is called, the song is called Crossing the Panj. Which I don't know if I'm pronouncing that properly either. But yeah, I really like these guys. I can't remember exactly how I came across them. These are the gateway to the Arctic Catharsis label for me. This album and this song is the main reason I emailed these guys. I said, hey, I want to play music by Hashshashin. And they're like, sure, but you can play all of our music. You know, kind of like how Ipecac was, right? I wanted to play Mike Patton. And then I said, hey, like, actually, can I play anything? And they're like, yeah, absolutely. So that's kind of what I did with these guys as well. And which I'm glad I did, because it is a very fruitful label. It's amazing. But yeah, so this stuff here, the closest thing I would compare it to something that we both know and like would be Tool. It's got kind of a Tool vibe to it. But other than that, I don't want to spoil too much, because it's, to me, it's better than Tool. You know, it might not be as good as Tool's, you know, it doesn't pound your ears with the sonic precision of a million-dollar budget record. But it's musically sophisticated, adventurous, rhythmically fun, and it's just a hell of a good song. I don't think I've ever shown it to somebody that went like, eh, not for me. You know, it's universally awesome.
Oh, my goodness. Wow.
I said that was the end, actually. I was like, I'm just getting ready for whatever's coming next.
I know, I had to look at the Bandcamp page to see if that was ending or whether it was just going to go into the next little thing. That was sensational. That's really, really quite a unique recording in a lot of ways. The sense of the room that I got right away, in fact, when it first started to play, I had to take my headphones off for a second to make sure my speakers weren't on because I felt as though something was coming into the room with me. Whether it's they're recording in the same kind of room as I'm in, I don't know, but it was, whoa, what is that? And then I felt as though the room changed. I felt as though they weren't sticking with the same room, especially for the drums. I felt as though they were mixing it rather than just a live performance using different elements. I felt as though they were mixing that room somehow. I'm just looking on as I'm speaking. I'm just looking on the Bandcamp page to see if there's any information about that. But there's not. Doesn't really tell us where it was recorded or. Well, it was recorded and mixed by Tim Carr at One Flight Up. So it was all done in the same place. And they've got a room that sounds really good. And that's one of the things that makes that track. There's of course, all of the musicianship that goes into all that kind of stuff and creating the, if you like to call it, the ethnic feel or the slightly Eastern feel to it, or the very Eastern feel to it. And I'm looking and seeing that they're using Moroccan crakabs. They use a didgeridoo at some point, which wasn't on that track. An Irish bouzouki, a Persian sitar. And you could hear, I'm sure there was bits of that in that track there, where things that sounded a bit like guitars but weren't. I love the way that they positioned them in the stereo as well. If anybody's listening with good headphones and you could hear the way the stereo was being kind of slightly molded around your ears, that was brilliant. That was really good. That's another one I've got to investigate now. Oh dear, they have a CD. It's sold out, sadly, but I'll track it down somewhere. I'm going to listen to some more of that. Yeah, that was great. They've got a whole spiel there about the sitting on the border of Afghanistan, the region of Badakhshan, and I felt the. I don't know if it's a desert or not. I mean, that's what you always think about these places, don't you? Because that's just the imagery you get. But I really felt the sort of grittiness of the sand and the kind of the winds, the very dry winds washing over the kind of rocky landscape and all of that. I love the dynamics of it as well. The fact they started off big and then went kind of smaller, and that room was really resonating at one point, then not so much. That was really good. In fact, it was such an extraordinary recording. I almost feel, you know how they talk about studios having a certain sound, and I think it's one of the studios at Abbey Road. They haven't painted it since the 60s because they can't get the.
They're afraid the paint will sound weird.
They can't get the same paint, so they've just left it. I speak apocryphally. I have not been there. I don't know this, but I felt as though I could hear the paint in that room. You know, that was a very special room. They'd given that room a role in that production. I definitely felt that, and it was a good sounding room, and they managed to make the best of it. Yeah, and that's some drummer as well, eh? That's some.
He's fantastic.
He's going Raj. He's going Raj in those drums. Yeah, very good, very good. Really loved that.
It's funny, you know. You talk about the room a lot. When listening about the reverb and how things react, and there's a band I think you would dig here in Canada that they recorded their first album in like a log cabin, and
right.
And then because of that they changed the name of their band to Timber Tomber because of the wonderful timbre or wonderful effect the timber had on the timbre on the inside of the on the from the room they were recorded in,
and the timber on the timbre.
Yeah, so now every time I hear Timber Tomber, I think about you, because I'm thinking that's something you notice.
I definitely do notice the rooms. I'm very interested in the sounds of studios, because when you record, as most, you know, most professional music is recorded in a space, especially if there's a drum kit. You know, if there's no drum kit, then really all you're hearing is the electronics. But when you have to have a drum kit, you've got to do something with that. And the best way to make that sound extraordinary is to put it in an extraordinary sounding room, a room that suits it. You know, and that way you get round all of the problems. I recorded a drum kit. It's probably the only time I've ever recorded a drum kit. I recorded it with one stereo mic, which you'd be told you can't do that. But if you put that mic in the right place in the right room, you'll actually get a good sound. My sound was nothing as good as that, of course. But I'm very interested in the room. And a lot of these rooms are now gone, of course. A lot of the classic albums, the Yes albums from the early 70s, those rooms are long gone. But you can still, AdVision, I think, was where they recorded a lot of the Yes stuff. And I didn't know when I visited London in 1985, we tried to get a record deal in 1985, and we went to one of the places, it was Zomba Records, where a lassie called Samantha Fox used to record, and that was all I knew about it. And it wasn't until last year I found out that was AdVision. I was sitting in AdVision where Yes recorded their albums, and I was, if only I had known at the time, I would have paid homage. But I didn't know. So yeah, I'm very interested in that. I always look to see where the studio is. If it's a famous studio, you can go and look at pictures of it. You can find out how it works. I find all that fascinating. Once spoke to an engineer called Phil Brown, I think was his name. And he had engineered the Talk Talk, a couple of Talk Talk albums. He'd also engineered a couple of John Martin albums. And he talked about that, the room. And he talked about how Talk Talk recorded, I can't remember which album it was, but it recorded the whole album with each musician in the same place for months on end. So if one of the musicians came in to record, he would be sitting in the same space that he sat in a week ago or 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, whether he was playing a different instrument or not. And they recorded that as a room. And when you listen to the album, you can actually hear it. So yeah, I'm very interested in the room. And that was a great room.
Well, good.
I've got something I think will, I don't know if it'll follow that, but we've been talking about country music, and so I guess that takes us to takes us to sort of acoustic-y type stuff, which we seem to have been sort of going in that zone. So I've got something I think follows that, and this is a Scottish artist called Jack James. I didn't write to Jack because he lets his stuff be played. So I'll contact him when the show goes out to let him know that this is available.
Perfect.
So I don't know if he's still active. His last album was quite a while ago now, I think, so he may not be active anymore. There's a couple of CDs you can get. They're great. They're really well produced. And I don't think he tells us really very much about where they're recorded. I think they're home recordings, but they're really good. And the track we're going to play is called Time of Death is Unknown, from an album called Third Culture Kid. And he talks a bit about what third culture means to him and what it means in the sort of great scheme of things. But we won't go into that. I just love the way this guy... This is his later album. I think this is his last album. And the way he developed from the first album to this album is really interesting to me. That's another thing I always do, as well as listen to the room, I listen to things in chronological order, because I think you can get a sense of the progression of an artist and how they've been feeling about the music. If they suddenly arrive at something, you can see the journey they took towards it, you know, and I find that very interesting. And this is a great album. The previous album is great, but I don't think it's quite as good as this. I think he sort of came into his own here. I've no idea what he's doing now. He's from Glasgow, which is quite near me, so I know the kind of environment that he grows up in, a very urban, kind of grubby environment. It's not pretty, you know, it's a kind of very utilitarian city that used to be industrial and is now sort of the sort of service economy that a lot of the UK has. So there's all of that going on. Whether any of that's in this track or not, I don't know, but you'll get it, I think. It's quite a short track. It's only 3 minutes 23. So, yeah, I just think this fits into the sort of oeuvre of what we've been playing so far. So, this is Time of Death is Unknown by Jack James from the album Third Culture Kid. ¶¶
was on out to get me. I can't find my way home. The roads look different in the night. Time of death is unknown. Time of death is unknown. Send the girls on to help them. They can't do it alone. Send the clowns in while you're at it. Death is unknown. Time of death is unknown.
That put me in a weird headspace for a minute there. Kind of, I shouldn't say for a minute. I'm still in that weird headspace. I've been thinking a lot about death recently, you know, and it's probably because I have a baby in the house, you know, and I'm thinking about those, you know, the inevitable pain. You know, if things go to plan and go well, I'm gonna break her heart one day, you know, and you know, and that's a scary thing for me to know that, you know. I hope to carefully nudge her through life in a beautiful way, you know, and to know that one day I won't be there to help her. I won't be there to help with the questions and the everything else. But anyway, that's a beautiful song. I love the, you know, it was a little raw, you know, like the. Right off the bat, you hear the guitar, and it's you can hear the amplifier buzzing. They made no effort to try and remove that at all, or mask the fact that it's just a mic in front of an amp, you know. And it was a nice sounding amp, beautiful guitar tone, and then a lot of that left right stuff going on. Right, the piano I think is in the left earphone for the whole song, right, and there's a second guitar in the right earphone for the whole song. And I don't know, it was a good tune. It reminded me a lot of a musician. I don't know if you know or not, called, his name is Mishka Shubali. He's an author, and a musician, and he's Canadian. He's like a literary genius. Like he went to university when he was like 14 or 15 years old for literature and was like being touted as like the next big, he was going to be like the next literary genius. You know, they're comparing him to. Like I can't even think of any names right now, but like some of the most celebrated writers of all time. They thought he would be like the next guy, and he's capable of it, but he, because he's so smart, he's so ridiculously disenchanted with life and the world that he's become like this, like, bar hopping relentless drunk, you know, like this, he's like a preacher to broken people. And his, this guy reminds me of him, this Jack James. His voice had a similar vibe to it, and this like sort of dark sort of, this is more sophisticated than what I'm talking about. The guy I'm talking about is a little more of a falling down drunk wearing a lampshade on his head kind of guy. There's something very insightful about that, and just like the line there of him, like, you know, at the end there where he's laying in bed dying, you know, and his family saying goodbye to him or whatever is supposed to be happening there. That was, it was good. I don't know. That was, he had to definitely tap into something, or he was going through something when he wrote that, for sure. So Jack James, eh?
Yeah. I think it's quite a Scottish sound for me. I mean, the, you know, send the boys in out to get me, so he starts the song, because he can't find his way home and all the roads look different in the night, the time of death is unknown. That kind of lyric is something that, I don't know why I would say that, but it sounds very Scottish to me. There's a very, I don't know if you know the word doer. Do you know the word doer? Is that a word that you have?
Isn't doer a Scotch? Doers?
All right. No. That's D-E-W-A-R. So no, doer, D-O-U-R, doer, it means down. And, you know, if you said someone was, oh, he's an off-y doer soul, it's like, you know, he never smiles. He's always like, you know. So that was a doer song. I hadn't remembered that when I was setting it up, because, you know, my brain just farts itself to death these days. But I'd set it up as an acoustic song, and it's not an acoustic song at all, but it has an acoustic feel to it. And his previous album was, that was why I was getting confused. But yeah, it's a very sort of, is it Cohen-esque? Is it like, is it the kind of thing that Cohen would have written? Is that sort of, I get that feeling.
Yeah, it definitely has a Leonard Cohen vibe. Very much so. Yeah, I get that. I find Leonard's voice is a little drier and less expressive. I mean, he's got a great voice. Don't get me wrong, but I like Jack's more, actually. I would take Jack's voice over Leonard's voice. But it's got
I'm not a fan of Cohen's, really. I like his words, but I don't like the rest of it. He's a poet. Yeah. In my mind, Cohen is a poet rather than a performer. He's just an acquired taste that I never got.